That was actually a candid photo. So it says Optimus Prime, like the prime worker of my factory. That's where it is. So I'm actually doing welding. And I was actually telling one of my welders, that's how you need to weld. And those are the skills I learned initially when I was in college. That's just a brief. So the theme of my presentation is believe in yourself. That's more like it. I don't want to teach you mechanical engineering in 15 minutes. It's the crash courses are available, but not that easy to. But you need to go through a grind of 4 years to know that. I would like to give you some lessons I learned so that maybe something in this works out a little easy for you. 20 years, that's close to 1,000,000 minutes. I just calculated today. When I was telling my batchmates, we have a group on WhatsApp saying, you know, going back to Somaya after 20 years, I was sitting exactly where you guys were in 1997. And on a small calculation, it turned out to be 1,000,000 minutes. It turned out to be 1,000,000 minutes. That's a lot of time. So 97, I entered Somaya, and unceremoniously 2001, I finished, thankfully in 4 years. By the way, that's the reason why on the first screen I wrote a batch of 2017 entering, because unfortunately not all of you might be in the same hall when you're graduating. That's the sad reality, but that's one of the lessons there. Then I went over to, in 2003, I went over to the US, did my master's in mechanical engineering. So I immediately went to do my master's after my BE. I got campus recruited with L&T. I spent the entire thing going, signing up and all. But at the last moment, I decided, let me finish my studies in one shot, which I feel was a good decision for me. Maybe if I would have gone and worked somewhere, I might have not turned out to be the entrepreneur I was. So. But what works for you, works for you. Each one is different. So you need to see where your passion leads you there. And then came back in 2003 back to India. Didn't want to work in the US or anywhere else. Came back and joined my father's business. It was a small setup that he set up in 91. From there, grew it on. Set up a factory in 2005, one more in 2009. And as of today, we have about 150 people working with us. We proudly make in India and deliver worldwide. That's as I said, the journey started here 20 years ago, because that's where it sowed the seeds of me being a mechanical engineer. So from there, I graduated from Texas A&M, came down back to India, set up a company, did a lot of work for people like Ratan Tata or Manmohan Shetty. I'm doing lifting systems right from lifting systems, which includes we lift small parcels as light as 50 kgs or something as heavy as a nuclear missile or an elephant. So these are all the systems that we do. And in a way, a lot of things that I learned during my course helped me. Might not be able to pinpoint saying, okay, Professor Pusnur's that lecture, I learned this, which is important, or Professor Chandrasekhar's this lecture, I learned this. But it gives you a platform. It gives you a confidence to be a mechanical engineer. That's where you can then go. Like I said, what I do today is we design, we manufacture, prototype, conceptualize, and service. A lot of these skills will be learned during your course there. So I would like to just give 10, I've just made 10 sentences which I thought would be useful to you in a little verbose way. So we'll go through 10 rules of success, or I wouldn't say maybe I'm absolutely successful or what, but I believe I've gone through the journey. So whatever I learned in the way, I would like to show it to you. The number one rule of success always begins with believing in yourself, because this is the one rule without which nothing else will work. If you don't believe in yourself, even if your parents do, your teachers do, your girlfriend, boyfriend believes in you, but if you don't believe in yourself, you won't go anywhere in life. So, so when you believe in yourself, believe in it all the way, implicitly unquestionably. Unless you believe yourself fully, nothing's going to work. We are what we believe in. Whether you believe you're right or you believe you're wrong, both ways, you're always, you know, you're absolutely right in that way. If you don't believe in yourself, whatever skills you have, it's useless. To accomplish great things, we must not only act, not only plan, not only dream, but also believe. Unless you believe your dreams, you'll just be, you know, waking up in the morning, going through your day and never accomplish them. In order to succeed, we must first believe that we can. That's the first step. If you don't take that first step, you won't go anywhere. One of the quotes of Steve Jobs, your work is going to fill a large part of your life. Your work, your study, whatever else. The only way to be truly satisfied in what you're doing is to do what you believe is great work. So whatever you do, unless you believe it's great work, you're never going to be satisfied. So whether it's your assignments, whether it's a course you're doing, it's an internship you're doing, or some college interview you're going to, you're never going to enjoy it unless you truly believe that that's what you want to do. The number two rule of success is break the rules. So when I say this, I don't mean break the law. The law is, you know, those are ironclad rules by which society functions. These are break the rules. Because trust me, if you look at any great success story that you see out there, whether it's an entrepreneur or a politician or somebody who's doing social service or even a cricketer, they've always broken the rules. They have never been, like, you know, keeping up to a certain decorum that is maintained. If you do that, you'll live a great, ordinary, average life, and by the time you're finished, within one generation, maybe people will forget you. The people we'll remember, the people we cherish, the heroes we worship, are the ones who broke the rules. So remember from today, anything that you do, do not be cast in whatever rules are there. Rules are made great, but unless you break them, you're not going to go to something different. The number three rule is, don't be afraid to fail. And this is something that even Dhananjay has mentioned, saying, if you fail, it's okay. Because there are only two results or outcomes of any event. One is you win or succeed, and the second is you learn. So the day you make this paradigm shift, so the two results of any outcome are not win and lose. The two outcomes are win and learn. So if you fail, it's a learning for you. But also the most important thing you should see is, you should not be afraid not to try. That's because if you fear failure, and if you think that, oh, the outcome of this is going to be that I'm going to fail, and that makes you not try, that is a big failure, my friends. So remember to get out of that fear of failure, of not trying. That's the failure that you need to get over, not the sense of failure itself. The number four rule of success is do what you love, right? So maybe one of you wanted to be a painter, maybe one of you wanted to be a fisherman. It's great if you can do that today, but that's not true for everybody. Right? So maybe that's your long-term goal. Maybe at 55, you want to be a fisherman back again, have your own palatial villa, and you can sit and fish. But till then, love what you do today, because that's in your control. What you do today, maybe once you finish for graduation, you don't get your dream job. Your dream job is to work for Tesla, maybe. But not everybody would do that, right? So wherever you get a job, be happy there. Love that. And then you see what the magic happens. You start excelling in whatever you do. When you are in college, like question was asked, saying, did all of you wanted to be mechanical? Everybody loudly said yes. That's okay. Inwardly, some of you might have wanted to do computers. Some of you might have wanted to do IT. Some of you have wanted to do electronics, maybe. But now that you're in mechanical, embrace it. Believe that you want to be a mechanical engineer, else you'll go 3 years down the line, you'll get frustrated, and then, you know, you might not go anywhere. So either you move out today, or else you learn to love what you're doing. Because being a mechanical engineer is still not the end of the road. Like Dhananjay was saying, the best coders may be in a, you know, in a plant, the ones who are mechanical or production.
Yeah.
You can't teach mechanical or production to a computer-based guy. So you're actually beating competition by being there. You can go and get the job of a computer engineer. Computer engineer can't take a job. And looking at the way the world is going, it's never going to be one single discipline or one single domain that is required. Multidisciplinary fields are going to be everywhere. So Apple, the great thing or the future for Apple or a Tesla today is not that they're making a phone, but it's that they've designed the hardware. Software can be done by anybody. It's that tomorrow they're doing a driverless car. Who do you think does it? Somebody sitting on a computer coding alone? No. There is materials, there is mechatronics, there is communication, there is so many things. So the field is wide open for you. Don't be stuck to where you are right now. Don't get frustrated. Love what you're doing. That will be a key to success.
Batteries.
Number five rule of success. So, you participate and be in the moment. Because every event, every day that you have, if you believe in the morning that it's going to be just another day, a boring day, and it's a waste of your life, it will turn out to be true. But if you get up in the morning, open to the, you know, opportunity, that's when it will change for you. You'll have a lovely day. Number six rule of success, value everybody's contribution. This includes people, this includes your subordinates, your, you know, team members, your teachers. Everybody who's interacting with you is giving you a certain part of their lives and time. Always value it. Always treat everybody with respect, whether it's a beggar on the road or your sweeper who comes there. They're doing a job. Always treat them with respect. That's the reason, that's the only way where you will grow in your life. Number seven rule, communication. This seems to be a very simple topic. What is communication? I'm talking in English, blah, 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 and finish. No, a lot of people have, you know, terrific ideas out here which are never communicated or they're not able to be communicated. Einstein used to say, you know, there is one place in the world where the best brains lie, the best ideas lie. And, you know, there's nothing like it ever. You know what place that was? The cemetery. People die taking their ideas in their brain and not being able to communicate to other people. Why do you think an Elon Musk gets funded billions of dollars when he is not even able to make one car out? It is because he was able to communicate his ideas that I can make a spaceship that can go into space. On one side you have Boeing and Airbus trying to see how they can make a plane more efficient. Here is a man trying to communicate to his investors that I will take people to Mars. People will think you're mad, right? But no, people bought in that. That is why he was able to communicate his passion. He got the best of people coming and working with him. He was able to communicate to his investors. He was able to get them to come and fund him. And he was able to communicate to the people. They bought in the dream, which is Tesla today. So unless you learn to communicate, believe me, nobody is a born communicator. You need to work on it, right? You might have seen speeches of Winston Churchill, but you don't realize that he used to practice his speeches 5 times before he used to come. And then all the people used to get so aroused. Hitler. Do you think he used to make his speeches extempore? No way. He used to have 5 writers who used to write speeches. He used to select the best one. He used to practice it and then give it across. Narendra Modi, you think he just stands there and gives a speech? No. Since 20 years, he is practicing his communication ability. Because that's how he has bought into you, right? It's not that he's just coming and saying, "Mereko vote do," and like fools will go and vote. You are believing what they're saying. That is a different level of communication. But even you, at your level, whether you're writing something, whether you're speaking something, you need to hone your skills. That will not happen automatically. I think you have a subject called communication skills in your first semester. I mean, I'm sure for all of us, it was a joke. Communication skills. We are born in Bombay. We are all living in an urban area. We know what to communicate. But the real fact is, the real communication, if you master, trust me, even if you don't have technical ability, you can do wonders. So that is one skill that you have to learn, and that is my rule number 7 for success: communicate better. What is there one entity that is common to Bill Gates, who per minute earns $23,000? Okay, his earning is $23,000 per minute, versus a beggar who's sitting maybe at the corner of Haji Ali begging, and he gets maybe 1 rupee a minute. What is common between the two of them? It is time. Time is something you cannot manage, right? We hear about time management. There are a lot of management gurus who will come and say, we'll teach you time management, this, that. You can't really manage your time. The time will tick. Whatever it is, whatever you do, 1 second will be 1 second anywhere in the world, even out of the world, in space. What you can only do is, what you do with the time is your decision. So whether you want to spend that minute on Facebook to see what your friend is doing, what your friend is eating, where they have gone, where they posted, take a selfie. Do you want to do that, or do you want to invest it into something else? There's no right or wrong answer. The answer is what you feel it is. It's your verdict of your mind. It will tell you what is right or wrong at that moment. But the moment, if you did that 5 minutes ago, you can't recover that. You can absolutely not recover that. So remember this. I mean, these are the lessons I wish somebody had told me when I was sitting in your space. We all took it for granted, saying, okay, we bunk class, go for a picnic. So if you see it from the way that, okay, you spent your time in a fun manner, you wasted it. But if you thought that I'm investing my time into, like, you know, spending time with friends, relaxing, so that then I can maybe do better in my studies. If you look at it from that perspective, great. But how you look at it is your function of the time there. So time will always slip through your hands. You will always feel you're running late for everything. You'll always feel that you don't have time. But if you see the people who are, like, great, if you see the people who have achieved something in their life, they will be absolutely effortless. They will do 100 things in a day and do it without effort. There will be no effort in their face. They'll go from place to place. I've interacted with Ratan Tata. Somebody like him, you might think, is frenetically running here and there. No way. They have everything sorted out. Why? Because he's managing his energies in line with the time. Right? So those are the lessons you need to see. Have you ever seen him post selfies on Facebook? I don't think so. So be careful about what you do. Unfortunately for you guys, social media is a big distraction. It's very easy to, you know, for me to say, saying you guys should not spend time on, you know, Facebook, not do this, not do that. But when Facebook began, even I used to spend half an hour to 1 hour a day on Facebook, till a point of time I realized this is absolutely wasting my time. Just packed up my account and ran away. But it will take you some time to get there. But remember, Facebook is not an investment. Always remember there are two aspects of your time. One is investment, one is expenditure. You know the difference between them? What you invest will give you dividends in the future date. What you spend will not give you dividends. Right? So always be careful about investing your time into the right things. Number 9 rule is, I think, one of the most important rules of all time. Never stop learning. Right? You come for a 4-year engineering course, your learning doesn't end there. You go home from class, your learning doesn't end there. Each and every second and minute of your life, till the time you die, you need to keep learning and have it open. You know, the day you stop learning is the day you stop growing, says Warren Buffett. And I think he definitely knows what he's talking about. My father is 70, and even today, he spends time learning new things. He's curious about knowing what's happening. He sees the new technologies and learning. That is real passion of engineering. It is not to see what is written in your book and just mark it up for your exam and you pass. You might get 100 marks, but who knows whether you'll use it or not and in what way. So if you want, if you see everything as a learning lesson, you can learn equally from a 5-year-old daughter. Amazing management skills can be learned from a, you know, from my 5-year-old daughter I learned. I'm sure all of you must have learned from your children. So if you see everything from a learning perspective, there is no limit to where you can reach. And finally, the last rule I put up here is also a very important rule, is about giving back. You have received a a lot of people's efforts, a lot of people's knowledge, a lot of people's hand in where you are today. You got the CET marks, get you to reach here. But do you know who's responsible for it, in a way? Can I know who's responsible for it? It's also partially your parents' success, right? They worked a lot, as much as you or maybe even more, to make you reach where you are. So there is always somebody behind you who has reached there. That is the reason why you need to give back. I took a lot from this institution. These guys took a lot from this institution. Why do you think we are coming here? I mean, I'm not coming here because I want to come and give a speech to you guys going away. It's a part of me wanting to give back. Lessons that we learned, stuff that you've not got done. If you're rich, great, give a part of your money. That's why you hear about Bill Gates doing philanthropy. But have you ever heard of Bill Gates' wealth reducing because of his philanthropy? No way. When A.M. Knight from L&T says, by the time he is dead, he would have donated 75% of his net worth to philanthropy. It is not because they want their name to be seen on some building. Why do you think Skumaya started this institution? He could have easily remained in his sugar mills, be a sahukar, and done this. He set up his institution with a lot of hard work, with the view of giving back. There is this, the approach of giving back should be always there in your mind, and it's not money. Money is the easiest thing to give. So if you pass somebody and give 10 rupees out of your pocket, is the easiest thing to do. But give more. Maybe tomorrow when you have a fresher coming in, spend 10 minutes with that guy and explain to him what are the lessons you learned in your 1 year. That is a great giving back. Right? So these are just summarized, some 10 rules that I could hear about. And in terms of being in touch, you can be in touch with the alumni. You guys are free to come and visit my factory. It's in New Bombay. We make a lot of things that would excite you as mechanical engineers, and I do take up interns during the summer or winter breaks. I've had students even come from the US to do their summer internships at my end, and you're welcome there. We would maybe not right away. You should come with some little background, like has been already told. If you don't have passion and desire and you're coming to my design office as intern, we cannot teach you how to do design. But if you already know a little bit of design, working on a live project will teach you a lot more if you want to do it that way. So that way is always open. And all the very best to you. Enjoy, have fun. That's the number one thing. Any questions you guys want to ask me? Either it was, okay, thank God. So I was thinking that it was so flat that nobody understood anything.
Well, it's just a general question. First of all, good morning to everyone. I wanted to know how would you find the funding and the materials to do your project work during your college days?
It depends upon, see, who would fund you the most. It's somebody who would use that information or knowledge that your project is based on. So just to give an example of the solar, suppose somebody has great interest in solar and wants to do research there, who would they approach? They would approach a company who's already doing work on solar, non-renewable energy, or maybe even the government. Go seek a grant. If somebody is, we do a lot of hydraulic machinery. So if somebody is wanting to do a project, something related to hydraulics, they would search for a company like me, write in, always first mail in, and then say, this is what we do, this is a synopsis, and this is what I hope to achieve. This is my fund. Then maybe the company might say yes. If they don't, then at least take a learning. Speak to those guys, say, can we come and meet with you? Because money is not everything. Sometimes the mentorship opportunity that you would get by meeting these guys is beyond compare. Yes?